So I've been working on the book, the pack. Oh, I brought you a copy, by the way. So we can remember that. Been working on the book about panic attack, and I've been really learning a lot about fear and about how it affects us and the torment and everything. And also how it kind of keeps us captive to certain things. Okay, so we talked about this. If you want to change your behavior, you have to change the way you think. Mm-hmm. And how you think will be based on what information you're exposed to. And like, as with panic attack or any destructive type of thinking, I use the example, when we used to go to the mountains, we used to drive logging trails. And after a while, you really couldn't do anything but just get in the ruts and follow the ruts. And if you wanted to pull out of the logging trail, you would actually have to fill it in with stuff, almost like a ramp, and pull out. What people have gotten themselves into is a pattern of thinking where a rut is formed, and then they can't consider any other thought except that. And you actually have to fill it in. And what we do is we fill in those ruts by truth. And so when we're up there and we're driving logging trails, we're stuck in one path. But the whole awesome thing is if everything can be leveled out, and then you can press in to have God teach you how to think, you think according to His wisdom, then you actually create ruts that are awesome. Strongholds are kind of demonic ways of thinking that take us a certain way. But then when you can think in line with the kingdom of God, then your thoughts take you to places where your behavior follows God. So what you were just talking about, Lot's wife, her thoughts caused her behavior. Look back. Let's just say a person wanted to, there's a lot of things that maybe aren't best. They're not a heaven or hell issue, you know, but let's just take smoking, for instance. Well, people kind of incorporated that into a lifestyle, and then it's, because it is wrapped in your lifestyle, it's hard to think differently, so it's hard to behave differently. Sometimes for me, during football season, I'll be thinking during the day, wow, I can't wait to get home and see the game I recorded. You know, I don't watch them in real speed, I watch them in fast speed so you can get through it. But it's interesting that as you're thinking through the day about this, you would get disappointed if you couldn't do that. Mm-hmm. So you start creating a behavior by thinking or meditating on something. Oftentimes when I'm dealing with young kids and people get together and they kind of have this dependency on each other, like high school kids and stuff, and then you see a breakup happen. One is ready to move on, one isn't. Well, the one who isn't is devastated. The one who has moved on, their thoughts are off of this and onto something else. So this is no issue for them. But for the one who still wanted to be in a relationship, they have these deep ruts where they cannot see life without that person. Mm-hmm. And so one thing to learn about protecting yourself is, and this takes a lot of work. It sounds like it shouldn't take work, but it does. You can't let anything rise above in your thinking or your importance above God, because God will never leave you or forsake you. And he'll lead you and guide you to all truth. But when you're wrapped up in something, what you have to give up, or what you need to give up, or forced to give up even, is never as bad as it seems like it'd be to give it up. A lot of times when I come back and talk to those teenagers again, I'll talk to the one who really wanted to stay in a relationship and they were devastated, but then they've kind of moved on and found someone else. And I say, how are you now? Oh, yeah, there's no problem, it's over. Okay, now it's over. Why? Well, either you have substituted with someone else or something else and you have downplayed it. Okay? So, this is going somewhere. I'm just trying to take us there in a good path. But it's interesting that they are okay now, but before then life was over, okay, in their words. So if you think about what's happening today, sort of like what happened back then, like for a person who's just wrapped up in carnal activities, Sodom and Gomorrah probably provided a lot of really like major carnal food, like inappropriate stuff. What happens today is, okay, the Bible teaches us that to change the way we behave, you have to change the way you think. So that means you have to take every thought captive, according to 2 Corinthians 10, right? Well, the interesting thing is, has there ever been an age that has more information than this age?
Mm-mm. More revelation than ever.
But people are constantly on their phones, and really there's no silence anymore. So the devil has an avenue that he can continually train people to think a certain way. And unfortunately, that thinking then takes you to a behavior, and that behavior almost thinks like too much to overcome. Sounds really funny, but okay. Like Warren Roy likes Mountain Dew. Nothing wrong with that. But let's just say that something in Mountain Dew was wrong and he had to make that change. Well, the first initial response would be, you know, because you're so used to it. The way to make changes is to begin early to change the way you think so you can prepare your behavior to make a change.
Yeah.
Like, let's just say a person likes to smoke and then they mix that with having coffee and they kind of change it into
a lifestyle.
Well, it's like something they do. Yeah. So for me, what's really interesting is I was raised on TV, okay? So now I've gotten to the point where I discipline myself to its very good quality, like the old time shows. But what I find out is I like to mix, like having a meal and, you know, oh, I'm going to chill tonight, have a little salad, watch an old Perry Mason. But see what you're doing, you're starting to mix things and it becomes a lifestyle. Now, if it's not harmful, that's fine. However, if it starts overtaking you and becoming
your identity?
Yeah, and something that's going to take away your contentment if you don't have it. Okay? That becomes a real issue. So two huge verses, and they're so familiar. Romans 12:2. Something you just got to live off of. Romans 12:2. Talks about being conformed to the world, right? Well, how does the devil get us to conform to the world? By providing information from the world that we feed off of, which is the thought, so it eventually will develop your behavior. Okay, what you think, you're not going to behave separately from the way you think.
Sure.
So the devil's going to constantly hit you with information, and that information is going to start out by seeming innocent, and it's going to be very subtle tones that are going to start pulling you in a track that makes God much more insignificant. Anytime God's insignificant, we got a huge problem. Okay, because God's the only truth, the only pillar, the only thing that's be unchangeable. So if a person doesn't want to, you always have to kind of ask yourself, is there anything that's starting to grow in importance above God? Mm-hmm. And is there anything that I would have trouble letting go of? So if that behavior has been established, then the way to do it, the way to get rid of that behavior then is to start establishing thoughts that go against that. Mm-hmm. Frida, you said, I don't want anything between me and God. Okay. That protects the thought pattern. Her behavior is, I don't want anything between myself and God. Okay, that's a behavior. Now she backs up and says, okay, am I meditating on anything that could possibly pull me away from that? And as soon as something pops up, then you have to say, whoa. Okay. You know, you develop a relationship, that relationship becomes very important. Here's where the devil gets in. The devil operates by fear. So even with Lot's wife, could it be that she knew the right thing, but fear entered in, like, oh man, I'm really losing something. Can I take one last look, or can I just... Fear will drive you to intensified thoughts. Okay. So first of all, what the devil does is he gets you to try to establish on something that kind of exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And then what he'll do is start manipulating that by fear. So even though a relationship's wrong, fear drives us to want to hold on to it because it has been a security type of thing. Wrong behavior becomes a security type of thing. So the devil starts throwing fear in there. Well, what's the matter anyway? You're not going to be happy unless you have this. So what the mind is going and saying, oh my goodness, we can't do without this. So the behavior follows that. And people don't quite realize that. Because of that, you have to severely limit what you're exposed to. Okay? And you also have to make sure that your mind is being constantly renewed so that that's the way you kick out stuff that starts exalting itself above the knowledge of God. Okay. Now on the flip side, it's really interesting. It says, for the person that is able to believe, cleave to, and trust in Jesus, out of their spirit will flow what?
Rivers of living water.
Rivers. It's interesting, he didn't even say a fountain, or spring, or a stream.
That's true.
If you ever tried to stop a river, it takes work. Mm-hmm. one time there was a drought up north, and the river runs behind us, got so small that we actually dammed part of it up. Okay? And then when I started getting a little full, it was just beautiful waterfalls. But you know what? The first good rain, all our work was gone. Because you do not control a river and manipulate it without a ton of work. Mm-hmm. People can construct dams, but it takes a long, long time. And you take like a Mississippi River, I guess, is notorious for flooding. When the river, this is the whole thing. Yeah, it's kind of what I'm learning to live by. I'm starting to learn, okay, Holy Spirit's in me as a well for myself. Holy Spirit's in me for a river for someone else. I don't always have to be trying to do all the work and everything else. I have a river inside of me. All I have to do is direct that river, yield to that river, and support the flow of that river. Support myself as being a vessel that river comes out. The river will do it its own work. Mm-hmm. I don't have to keep traipsing down through the countryside. Now, where's that river going? No. Yeah. The river's Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit will take it to the right place, but it has to come out of me. Rivers of living water affect a lot of people because they continually flow. Holy Spirit can, what's really cool is whatever is seen is temporary. Whatever is not seen is eternal. Our words are eternal. So as Holy Spirit's in us and Holy Spirit comes out of us, in the words that we speak, in the direction that we give, we speak truth, it comes out of us in the form of a river. And it has the ability to change everybody's life that it comes in contact with. I don't know if you ever studied in Ezekiel about how the water was coming out of the temple when it flowed and formed a stream and everything. What was really interesting, it said, first of all, the Holy Spirit was guiding the person, and they went in up to their ankles, you know. And they said, well, this is really cool. Then took up to their knees, to their waist. And that says, pretty soon, my feet couldn't touch the ground anymore. So what happened was it was a total yielding to the river. Then when that person came out, they said they had the ability to see different. Wow, now I see that all the banks are lined with trees of life, trees of healing and everything like that. When you allow Holy Spirit who's inside of you to become that well that you live off of, and you yield to where you do not restrict the impact of Holy Spirit on you, it transforms you to be able to see differently. Mm-hmm. When you can see differently, you can think differently. Then you can behave differently. Mm-hmm. So what our life is it's this source for Holy Spirit, for this river to flow out of us, and it becomes life to all that it touches. And all we have to do is be that vessel that allows it to come out. Mm-hmm. Now what Holy Spirit is looking for is to bless everybody. What the devil's trying to do is to get us to be so ineffective as a vessel that we're so self-consumed on everything about ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, so wrapped up in junk all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, the spirit of offense shuts everything down. Karen, how many times have we seen this? You know, the stupidest, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
The most insignificant little thing. The thing that means nothing. People get hung up over and get offended. And what happens? Their mind and all their countenance goes to offense. And it shuts everything down because the Spirit of God does not flow through offense. It flows through a yielded vessel, yielded to the Holy Spirit. That's one of His strengths. He never gets offended. Okay, so Holy Spirit, we all have different strengths and weaknesses. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, I heard someone say this recently. If you go to bed with how does the scripture say, do not let the sun go down on your wrath.
Forgiveness.
When you go to bed like that and you carry that offense to bed, you then, no longer is the Holy Spirit your counselor. Mm-hmm. You are being counseled then by the devil because you've given him that place. Mm-hmm. And now he twists all the more these things that are happening, and it makes it worse and worse and worse. Because then he has you believing this about that person, that, and then more, he's putting more thoughts in your mind. And,
that's right.
And it gets worse and worse. No wonder God said, don't let that happen.
Right.
You know?
And there's another thing that you said that we talk about fear. The river's taking you, and as it goes up to your feet, your knees, your waist, and everything in you, there is a fear that people have when they can't touch the ground. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, they panic, and they struggle not to go with the flow of the world. Word, but go with the world, which is underneath their feet. Mm-hmm. They keep trying to, like, I've got to do what I've always done. I've got to keep my earthly grounding.
Out of instinct, that's the natural balance.
Right, and instead of the peace, joy, and contentment, okay, God, take me. You know, and finally getting to that point, and a lot of people are just to the point where their toes are still touching the ground, mm-hmm. and they've got to let go.
They don't know God enough. Their minds aren't enough.
Yeah.
That's where it's at, yeah.
So they're trying to maintain
control.
Right. See, that's what fear does,
yes.
That's what I was, like, just doing. Like, the whole time I've been doing that because, like, I only been seeing Holy Spirit as, like, streams for some reason. But now I just want to imagine, like, this dam that broke open and this huge flood of rivers just, you know, consuming somebody as I'm praying over them. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of just, like, springs just flowing into them when I'm praying over them, mm-hmm. I want to see, like, gushing water just, like, overtake them and, yeah, make them rise up off the ground.
Right.
Seriously, I want that heavy revelation when whoever I pray over.
Lot's wife looked back. What did Jesus say about the person plowing?
Exactly.
And looks back.
Mm, their row's not straight.
He's not.
Right?
I like that too.
Right?
He's not fit.
Yeah,
for the kingdom.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Because, and this is really deep, but if you're going to trust God and put your hand to the plow, which means walk out life led by Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. it's not your job to look back and evaluate the progress.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's not your job to critique.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so when you plow ahead, there's going to be some things that plow turns up. Some things in your life that just have to be let go.
Yeah.
And too many people try to add something new instead of becoming something new.
It's true.
So I want to just add God to a part of my life instead of God is my life, and then everything has to work around that.
Yeah.
Okay. So the way the devil works is he initiates fear. And then you get into speculation.
Yeah.
The definition of speculation
is to
shut up.
Think. Observe.
When you speculate, you are forming conclusions without firm evidence.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
The Bible says that we have what we say, that we are given the ability to create. A power flows out of us. Just when, like God created the earth, God made man and woman with the right to choose their words and to speak their own words, and those words carry power. Okay? So what the devil does is he gets you to speculate, which means I am kind of consumed with the thought of something and I'm trying to draw a conclusion without firm evidence. Well, guess what? The devil will supply you with every bit of evidence that you need.
Yeah.
And it's all in the form of a lie. Okay? If you think about how many times you've ever feared something, and then really look at how many times those fears were actually
catastrophic,
important, or valid.
Legit, yeah.
You know, and you go back and say, wow.
Didn't happen.
I'd say in my life it's probably less than 5%, maybe 2% of anything I've ever feared was actually worth fearing. Well, how is it we're consumed with speculation? Like we're trying to draw conclusions without evidence. We can go back to the term we use a lot. Well, you just shut up. In other words, you have to shut your mind down.
Yeah.
And you have to say, until I get evidence, I'm not going to speculate.
Yeah.
Because what happens is you're becoming a river of dying water for the devil. What's coming out of you is not only going to start destroying things in your own life, it destroys other things where people are. So how can good water and bad water come out of the same spring? It can't. So you're going to be one or the other. It was really interesting. Of course, I never obsess over things or dwell on anything, but a certain number of employees, the servers were, you know, someone mentioned, was like referring to God about things. They said, oh, you go to church, hope you don't go to Brian's Bible study thing. Well, have you ever been to Brian's Bible study thing? Well, they do this crazy thing where they lay on hands. Oh, so we follow the Bible. Okay. So we follow the Bible and study your church doctrine, and now you're not. But when's the last time you've been to church? Well, we don't really go to church, but, you know, God and me are we're friends, you know. Really? Okay. So in other words, what you're doing is you're stopping what Holy Spirit is doing. You're trying to get in there and reroute the river. And all it's going to do is eventually wash you away.
Hopefully suck you in to the flow of it.
And people don't realize how dangerous that is. The flow of Holy Spirit, you don't mess with that.
You don't manipulate that.
Okay. And especially not unless you're led by God or have something really directing you. And how quickly this spirit of offense can change your thoughts to where you're following and being led by the Spirit of God, to where the thing maybe you're really standing for and believing gets wiped out because you stop flowing with God, and while His provisions are right there, you're over in this direction. I want to be in, I want to be where the blessing is, so I'm blessed to be a blessing, just as I'm a source of the river, okay, a vessel. Holy Spirit, of course, is a source, but I meant to, it has, Holy Spirit does not act independently of God's people.
Right.
So we are meant to be filled with Holy Spirit, so Holy Spirit moves through us. Holy Spirit needs a ton of vessels.
Yeah.
Okay, so you get enough rivers flowing that are fun. And you should be known for being that river. Remember Tyler Snavely? Mm-hmm. It was really interesting. He texted me yesterday and said he had a really bad accident with his knee, where stuff was, ACLs were ripped and all this kind of stuff. And I haven't seen him for at least 5 years. It was really interesting. He texted me and says, hey, I was talking to Elijah Hershey. Mm-hmm. He received his knee healing on his knee at Foundry. And I was just wondering if you guys would pray for my knee. Well, yeah, because we do that, you know? Mm-hmm. That's what we do. And I got back home right away, and we sat down and prayed for it. Now, before I did, I took him through some testimonies. Hey, do you remember how Joel Wiggins got healed? You already know how Elijah got healed. Do you remember how Brandon got healed? Mm-hmm. And he says, well, yeah. I'm like, okay, now you're going to receive. But it brought up two things. When people, when your name comes up or when an issue comes up, mm-hmm. you need to be the go-to person. Mm-hmm. They've got to think about you. I doubt they called any of the servers up to ask them to pray for them. And those people will come when they hit a big thing. And I'm just making a little joke out of this whole thing, but it just amuses me the way people mm-hmm. who are wrapped up in a lifestyle that they themselves know is not correct. Misery loves company. As long as we have enough people that are doing wrong, then we can't feel too bad about it and we can continue. Mm-hmm. But if you got some people that are doing right, that becomes convicting all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, it's not my fault it turns into condemnation, because that's when the devil goes in there and starts pounding them over the head.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I don't condemn anybody. I tell them what I believe is truth from the Word of God, and the conviction can fall. But don't try to minimize the work of God so you feel better about your lifestyle.
Okay.
Just a little thing I'll throw in there. No extra charge.
Not bad at all.
The more you expose yourself to the world, the more thoughts you need to take captive.
Yeah. That's right.
This is why, again, I mean, I really work at not listening to certain things, but there's certain things that definitely get in there. And sometimes I'm not diligent enough, first to admit it. So, but when you learn and you think, okay, what am I meditating on, or what things come to the forefront? Mm-hmm. How big of a crisis has to take place mm-hmm. before it affects you? Okay. Frida, I know both of you know people who live by drama. And so they have these huge ruts that they travel. And anything that happens that's anywhere near to being drama, that'll just speed up their process of going through the same thinking. And where does it take you? Nowhere. And can you be a help to anybody else? Mm-hmm. No, you can only support negative thinking. Mm-hmm. You can only support the crisis, the drama. As people get around, they start discussing drama. What happens right away? People exaggerate mm-hmm. to be heard. Do you ever hear that?
They get stuck in the mud of the river.
Yeah. A lot of speculation goes on.
Yeah, so they're stuck in the same ruts. Mm-hmm. Then when they have something tragic in their own life that they need deliverance from, mm-hmm. they can't change the way their behavior is mm-hmm. because they can't change the way their thoughts are because they're stuck in a rut. Mm-hmm. So those ruts have to be filled with truth, and then they finally drive out. Mm-hmm. And then you create new ruts, okay? Mm-hmm. Strongholders believe negative patterns of thinking, but you can have fortresses of godly thinking. Mm-hmm. And one thing that's really wild, this is huge, but a stronghold is like a castle where a demonic realm can work from because they have the safety of your incorrect thought patterns.
Yeah. Right. It's a knockdown.
That's
wall.
Really heavy. Did you get that? So if a person's thinking complete incorrect thought patterns, that demonic realm can work from those, that work from the safety of that because the devil won't ever be called down by truth because there's new truth operating. In the absence of truth, a lie becomes your truth. So they work from a standpoint of lie. So just the way Holy Spirit fills a person who lives by truth and truth comes out of them, a stronghold is constructed in the mind where a pattern of thinking protects the demonic realm. Holy Spirit will only work through a person. The demonic realm works through a person. Okay? As the demonic realm tries to work and create a vessel to work from, they will correct an incorrect pattern of thinking that will support death, loss, and destruction. Because the devil only came to kill, steal, and destroy. So a person lets this be created. Okay? So the two key scriptures I like to live from. Don't be conformed to this world, this age, fashioned after and adapted to its external superficial customs, which right now the external superficial customs are social media, right? You ever go through the dining room?
Oh, God,
people are like
terrible.
This. You know, kids like this. What are you listening to? What are you filling yourself with? Mm-hmm. Okay, but this is it. This is the superficial custom right now. But be transformed or be changed by the